from Ezekiel chapter 47, and this is what the Bible says. In my vision, the man brought me back to the entrance of the temple. There I saw a stream flowing east from beneath the door of the temple and passing to the right of the altar on its south side. The man brought me outside the wall through the north gateway and led me around to the eastern entrance. There I could see the water flowing out through the south side of the east gateway. Measuring as he went, he took me along the stream for 1,750 feet and then led me across. The water was up to my ankles. Everybody point to your ankles. He measured off another 1,750 feet and led me across again. This time the water was up to my knees. Everybody point to your knees. And after another 1,750 feet, it was up to my waist. Everybody point to your waist. Then he measured another 1,750 feet, and the river was too deep to walk across. It was deep enough to swim in, but too deep to walk through. Everybody do this number. It was over my head. Sometimes when we are worshiping the Lord, the Spirit wants to take over. He wants to take you so deep that it is too deep to walk through. It is over your head. It is surrounding you on every side. And that, my friend, is the true presence of God that we were hearing about this morning. When the Spirit is given the freedom to flow in our service, we can lift our hands and get lost in His presence. Amen. And that's the kind of service that I want to be a part of. So let's pray this evening and invite the Spirit in. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity, Lord, to be in your house tonight. We thank you for all the things that our church is involved in and doing, that we are a church who is alive. God, we thank you, Lord, that you are a God who is alive and that you want to take us deeper than we've ever been before. God, we pray that you will let your Holy Spirit flow in this place, God, that we will offer you up a praise that is so sweet, that is so great, God. Father, we pray that you will let your perfect will be done tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord tonight? Everybody have a good Mother's Day. Hopefully all the moms did. I don't know about the guys having it, but you know. But anyhow, let's worship the Lord tonight. Would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood. Power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonderful power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonderful power in the precious blood.
Oh,
lift it up.
I exalt. this beautiful sound over my shoulder, and I looked back, and it was people praising the Lord. Somebody say amen. Amen. Aren't you glad for that? I'm looking forward to the day when we get to heaven, and there is a constant ringing of praise throughout the glory world. Amen. I am looking forward to it. Amen. I'm going to take us into a business meeting. Is that okay? Anybody want a motion that we go into a business meeting? Norman, anybody want to second it? Steve-O, we got it. Anybody not want to go into a business meeting? Raise your hand. Great. So we're going into a business meeting now. That's awesome. I'm coming to you tonight to ask for permission to buy a new computer system in the back. One thing I hate about being a pastor is spending money. Amen. Amen. But that computer system back there, according to Jim Brunn, who is a and Robert over here, too, who are computer geeks, it's probably, according to Jim this morning, it's probably got a couple weeks, maybe a month or so longer to last us, and we really need to upgrade. And before I give you the cost, have you know we have people watching us on the Internet all the time. Yes. Amen. Robert pointed something out to me this morning. We consistently have somebody out in Utah that watches us. I don't know if they're watching us tonight, but if you want to turn and wave at the camera and say hi, those of you in Utah, I don't know. I don't know who they are. And wherever else you're watching us from, there you go. But that computer system, if you don't know, it's really important to the church. It runs the overhead, the music. You guys can jump anytime you want to.
It records all the services so we can produce DVDs, CDs of the services. It does the wireless broadcast. It does a lot that, more really than what it's really capable of doing when you ask, because it multitasks back there. We are running probably four programs at the same time right now.
Yeah, at least.
And when Jim brought it back this morning, he said half of our memory is gone. It's not working. So we're running on 50% power, and it just keeps going down. And it takes a lot of power to do internet broadcasts. It takes a lot of power to run this overhead. If you know anything about computers, it takes a lot of memory to do that. And how many of y'all know that, yeah, we can sit and be fine with status quo, but then what happens when we grow? And how many of y'all know we are growing?
Amen.
Amen. You know, we're going to need to be able to get better cameras so that the broadcast, when it goes out, it's going to be nice and crystal clear. You know, we've got the sound worked out, where the sound is beautiful that goes out. But eventually, we're going to have to get cameras. Eventually, whenever we expand in here, we're going to have the capability to project words up here and project words over there. We're going to have that capability. We need something that is powerful enough that will last us, that will enable us to do more things. And how many of you all know, if you don't realize this, that internet broadcast is very, very important. Because there are people out there that can't get into a church, that maybe this is their only church. And it's very important. And who knows, someone might be coming along it one day, and you know they'll tune in, and all of a sudden they'll hear something, and they'll give their heart to the Lord as a result of that. We don't know that. We may never hear that. But that can happen. And I am a person, and musicians know this, I believe in a spirit of excellence. And I think that God wants us to do things in a spirit of excellence. That's why whenever we play music, whenever we sing, I want it done right. And whenever we are broadcasting out to the world, if the world is out there and they see something that's muddled and they see something that's constantly having problems with being online, how many of you know they're going to tune it out? But if they look at something out there and they're like, wow, this is top quality stuff, they're going to tune in more frequently. So this is something that we desperately, desperately need.
I'll tell you, as a pastor, there are times that I'm on the internet looking for preachers to listen to and for music to listen to. people that stay home do listen to it on there, and we anymore, I mean, we're going to have to figure out a way to monitor this, but anymore, I get texts almost every service saying, I can't hear this, I can't see this. I mean, that goes to show you how the people are actually, they are watching us when we're, when they're not here. So,
and in order to upgrade, to make it better, we've got to have a computer that's capable of doing that. Mm-hmm. And right now, we're very, very limited in what we can do and what we can put out there.
Okay. Jim Brunn did some research for us on computers. You guys have to help refresh my memory a little bit here. It was about $1,000, wasn't it, for a computer system? This computer system, I think, is double, three, four times what we have now.
More than, yeah, at least.
So it has the capability to handle everything we need to handle on there. I have a couple of beautiful nursery-working ladies here that are wanting us to make sure we run a cable and some video into the nursery really soon. So I believe this will give us the capability to do that as well. The computer system is going to cost, I'd say, a little over $1,000. And there may be some other things that we have to buy. Not for sure exactly how much, but I'm just going to ask you to approve at least $2,000 to upgrade the computer system, run the stuff to the nursery for when it's done, and maybe we can fix whatever's going on the internet as well. Anybody have any questions about this, what we're bringing before you? Feel free to ask. The church has been very blessed the last 6 to 7 months financially. I don't know what this month is doing, but I know the last 6 to 7 months, every month has been a record for us. And in March, for tithes and offerings, we gave an all-time giving record for March. So, I mean, the church is doing very well. And believe me, I am somebody that does not like to come to you and ask for money. But, again, if we're going to continue to improve and continue to grow, which I believe is what we all want to do, we have to do this. So, if there aren't any questions, Keith?
The next few years.
I'll say something about this computer system. I mean, as far as computer technology goes, every 2, 3, 4 years, we're going to have to do this just to stay up with it. So, I mean, there are some costs to operating. That's just the way it is. I mean, if we want to stay small, then we don't have to worry about this. Yeah. Think small. But if we're going to think big and we want to reach people and, you know, I want the mission to be worldwide one day, which I think we're already pushing that. So, I mean, if we're going to do that, we have to keep this in mind, and we have to, you know, buy the technology. All right? I need a tithe-paying member to motion. Jerome is motioning to buy it. Lana is seconding it. Before we move on with the vote, is there any other questions before we take the vote? All right. All in favor of buying this computer system? Do you have a question, Dave? Nope. All in favor, raise your hand. Okay. All opposed, raise your hand. 100%. Thank you very much. In the next couple weeks, we'll have a new computer system. Praise the Lord. Give God a hand clap. I promise you I will try not to spend $2,000. I assure you of that. We have some young ladies tonight. My daughter and a couple other daughters that want to do some great things for their moms. So, Delana and Deanna, why don't you ladies come on up? What's that? David, too. Ooh, David, too? David, oh. Come on up. Ooh, here it comes.
All right.
Wow.
I said sister.
I am blown away.
Thank you.
We love you, Mom. Happy Mother's Day. We've had this plan, so I didn't mean to lie to you, but I didn't know what else to do. So
confession's good for
God
the soul.
Forgive me, but on my pro, on my right there. We love our mom. We've had her for, well, me, 19 years. I'm glad he gave me her. I don't know how else to say it. She's a praying mom, and I've seen results from that. And one thing she did taught us to do is trust God through good and bad times.
Okay, well, I found a story that went along well with our little signing thing we're going to do. It's a conversation between a person and God. So I'm going to ask God, can I ask you a question? And he says, sure. Promise me you won't get mad. And he says, I promise. Why did you let so much bad stuff happen to me today? And God's asked, what do you mean? What? Okay, well, I woke up late this morning. Yeah, my car took forever to start. Okay, at lunch they made my sandwich wrong and I had to wait. Okay, on my way home my phone went dead just as I picked up a call. Okay, and on top of it all, when I got home I just want to soak my feet in a new foot massager and relax, but it wouldn't work. Nothing went right today. Why did you let this happen? God says, let me see. The death angel was at your bed this morning, and I had to send one of my angels to fight it. I let you sleep through that. Oh. I didn't let your car start because there was a drunk driver on your route that would have hit you if you were on the road. The first person who made your sandwich today was sick, and I didn't want you to catch what they had because I knew that you couldn't afford to miss work. Your phone went dead because the person that was calling was going to give false witness about what you said on that call. I didn't even let you talk to them so you would be covered. Oh, and that foot massager, it had a shortage and that was going to throw out all the power in your house tonight. I didn't think you wanted that to be in the dark. I'm sorry, God. Don't be sorry. Just learn to trust me in all things, the good and the bad. Amen. And that's what our mom taught us to do, so this is her song.
Still God of the night.
Talk of faith.
was crying for her. Amen. In the back. I really was. My goodness. Praise God. That's an old song there, buddy. Look at these moms. Okay, it's good. Anyway, it's good. We're going to go ahead and take up our tithes and offerings right now. After they're done, I'll have Lorena come up and do a testimony, and then after that, Emily's got something she wants to do for her mama tonight, too, and then we'll move right on. So, ushers, would you please come forward, if Shelly can see through her tears, to take up your offering tonight? Amen. Steve-O, I think they want you to come sing, buddy. I'm going to ask Shelly Heath back there to stand and say the prayer of the offering, please. Come ahead, sir.
Well, you might own a lovely mansion, you might drive a fancy car, be a Hollywood attraction or a famous movie star. You might know the Queen of England, hang around with the elite. You might own a five-star hotel or a horse that can't be beat. But I know there'll come a day, well, when you'll trade it all away for what I have. What I have. Now all the gold in California, all the coffee in Brazil, all the stocks and bonds on Wall Street, all the $100 bills, they may occupy the daydreams of a more ambitious man, but my eyes are fixed on heaven and I'm sticking to my plan. Tell the whole world, even though they might not understand, they know just what I have, what I have. Well, what I have is a soul bought by the blood and sanctified. What I have is a little pool of tears where I cried. And I won't forget the day I've traded all my sins away for what I have, what I have. If you're searching for your answer and you can't find your relief, if you're craving satisfaction but all you find is grief, would you listen to a brother who's already been around? Put your faith in this old world will let you down. Well, Jesus Christ can save your soul, and I'm here to let you know he's what I have. He's who I have. Well, what I have is a soul bought by the blood and sanctified. What I have is a little pool of tears when I cried. And I won't forget the day I traded all my sins away for what I have. What I have, what I have.
Are you guys sure you got this?
Yeah, the twins are plugged in. Baby's asleep. How hard can this get?
We're men. Besides, I bumped into Chuck Norris at a Pizza Hut once. I think his power's rubbed off on me.
Get out of here. Go on, enjoy your mommy getaway weekend.
Oh, this weekend was a bad idea.
Do you remember what happened last time we watched the kids?
I'm not a piñata!
Get it off me! Get it off me!
Yeah, we're gonna need help.
Use of this product may alter your perception of reality.
Ah! right. Everything looks the same. This is a joke.
Guys. 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 It's like the Sahara in this cup. Can somebody hit me with some juice? And listen, pulp, no pulp, doesn't make a difference to me. You're the ones dealing with the diaper.
Mom goggles.
It's beautiful. Okay, sweetie, I need you to sit on your bottom. Listen to Daddy. You sit on your bottom, okay? Daddy's gonna come get you. Don't move. Don't dance. Just sit on your bottom. Daddy's gonna come get you.
Whoa, 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 whoa. Don't you try to stop me.
Baby made a poopy. Yes, you did.
Where are your mom goggles?
They wouldn't fit over my hazmat suit.
Take this.
Oh, so cute, baby.
And then the little boy, he rocked his mommy. Oh, I love you. Forever. I like you, too.
I don't know how they do it.
Oh, well, you take it and you fold it from corner to corner.
No, I'm asking the question, how do moms do all of this? How do they handle it all?
Well, maybe they have goggles we don't know about.
It's as if God gave moms a special way of looking at things, you know? Okay, who taught you servanthood? Who modeled grace? Who gave you a taste of what God's love could look like?
My mom, Mr. T, and my mom.
Anyway, I just think God gave moms a special way of looking at things. Hey, honey.
Hey, how's it going at home?
It's all good. Guess you could say I'm starting to catch a glimpse of what your world looks like.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Mama.
Hold on, your daughter wants to say something to you.
I did, Mama.
She says she misses you. And she realizes how important you are in her life. And she doesn't know how you do it. And she knows that she can't make it without you.
She said all that, huh?
I don't know if she said it. But it's what I wanted to say. And I should have said it a lot sooner. I thank God for you.
The twins.
It was nothing. We have to go, okay? Love you, Mommy.
Still Mother's Day, isn't it? We're gonna have a mom come up here and testify for us for a moment. Come ahead.
I just want to tell you that we serve a healing God. It may not be in our timing, but it's always His. I was born with scoliosis, and I suffered excruciating pain for 51 years. And that morning, I had convinced myself that I never hurt and I never complained. And that morning I woke up on November 4th of 2006. I was in so much pain and I couldn't walk. And I just walked by the mirror and I went, it scared me so bad. And I said, Lord, please heal this scoliosis. I went on to Sunday school, nothing happened. But I was in a good place if it was happening. So I went back to church that night, and no one touched me, prayed for me. They didn't know what kind of pain I was in. And I always sat with my arms crossed. Come here, Pastor. Hold this, please. I always sat with my arms crossed, and I was sitting like this, and my arm was bouncing like I was being hit from the inside out. And it didn't hurt, but my arm just kept bouncing. That was every bone in my body being pushed back into place. Amen. This went on for hours. You know, he could have done it instantly. But it went on for hours, and I never thought any more about it. And I woke up, and I went to work. I worked in a call center, and you couldn't even take a breath in between phone calls. And my phone quit ringing, and I had this big knot on my chest and on my back. And this hip was like 4 inches higher than the other one. And I could stick my fingers all the way up to the end of my fingers in my side. That's how bent and crooked I was. And I just, when my phone quit ringing, I ran to the bathroom and I was looking at all these spots. I was like, thank you, Jesus, I've been healed. But there was one more spot that wasn't healed. And when I started to sit down, my hip was hurting. And I got to take my own hand, push my hip back into place. I have not had any pain since November 4th. Of 2006. Amen. And I give all the praise and glory to God.
Amen.
I'm really thankful for my mom. She is the one who convinced me into the signing part of this, because singing is great, you know, but then signing just amps it up. So. Thank you.
I think that all of our moms need a big old hand clap right now. Standing ovation. How about that? Moms are awesome. Children's Church, go back quietly. Lori Jean.
Thank you, Harmon Wayne. Some of you know, some of you may not know, but this Saturday at Holmes High School in the auditorium, they are having a talent contest. It's the Battle of the Bulldogs, and it's the high school against the middle school, and Emily auditioned with what she just did, and she was picked to do with the song and everything. And the thing about it is they had to cut several acts. So she, when she auditioned, she wasn't even for sure she'd get picked. But, of course, you know, Mom just had no doubt that she'd get picked. So I wasn't surprised, right? But if you will remember her this coming Saturday, I know she's been inviting people left and right to come. And it is at the Holmes High School Auditorium at 2 o'clock this coming Saturday, the 17th. The admission is $1 or a canned good. So I know that she would love to see you come. Like I said, I know she's been inviting several people. I just think it's awesome. It's a chance for her to let her faith shine there at school. And when she auditioned, there was some middle schoolers and some high schoolers that were serving as the judges to decide who would get to be in the talent show. And one of the eighth graders is in class with Benjamin, and he told Ben, he said, I gave your sister out of between 1 and 10, I gave her a 10. I was like, yeah. So, and she's earned the right to be called Emily now from his friends, because they always say, hi, Ben's sister. So she said, Mom, I've earned the right to be called Emily now. Instead of Ben's sister. Yes, I said, well, don't worry, honey. I've been known as everything but Lori, because I was Brother Willem's daughter. You know, I'm Wayne's wife now. You know, I'm Benjamin's mom, Wayne's mom, Emily's mom. But I'm also Lori. Lori Jean, yes. It is good to be back in God's house tonight. You know, it takes a lot to get up here. You know, because you know what the number one fear is, right? Public speaking. Yeah. Did you know that? Yeah. So right now I am swallowing all my fear to be up here to speak to you. But it is good to have you here tonight. I appreciate what the girls and David did for their mother. I mean, you know, when your kids, it doesn't matter how old they are, when they do something for you like that, it just pulls on your little heartstrings, doesn't it? It does. And I'm just so thankful and grateful to be a mom. Are you glad to be a mom? Yes. And you know what? You don't have to physically have had a child to be a mom or a mom figure. You know that? Because you know what? We have some ladies in our church that don't have children, that never have had children, but they mentor children. You know what? And that's what a mom does. A good mom will mentor their child and point them in the right direction. And I'm thankful for the mother that I've had, and I'm thankful for the mothers that are here tonight. Amen. I'm going to sing, I'm going on with my Jesus just the same. Well, I'm going on with my Jesus just the same. Yes, I'm going on with my Jesus just the same. Well, you may false accuse me, scandalize my name, but I'm going on with my Jesus just the same. The narrow way is the straight way, it don't have no crooks or bends. I gotta go on for Jesus, cause I know he's my best friend. The enemy's all around me, tears from my eyes. I fall down on my bended knees, and these are the words I cry. Well, I'm going on with my Jesus just the same.
that of this I am sure is living, for I can feel him in my soul. And I'm going all by my Jesus to say, yes, I'm going all by my Jesus just to say, well, you may false accuse me, scandalize my name, but I'm going all by my Jesus just the same, yes, I'm going all by my Jesus just the same.
Amen. It's been awesome to spend some time with some mothers today and to see the kids love on them. And I was teaching children's church, and I had all the kids come up one by one and give their name and tell something about their mother. And every one of them was excited. Every one of them had something amazing to say about their mother. Sometimes I wish that we had a microphone that the mother could hear what the kids had to say about them. Because a lot of times I find out that when the kids are around their mothers or their fathers, they don't say those things. They don't. I went up to a couple of them and I told them, I said, they told me, my mom is special. God gave me my mom. I said, you know what? You need to tell your mom that today. Every one of them, when they got in the presence of their mom, they none of them said nothing. I had to kick them a little bit and prompt them a little bit and get them moving forward into that. But once they started talking, they were okay. But I kind of like the same thing, you know, it's just the way it is. One of the things I think about when moms is joy. You know, how does moms go through and do the things that they do for their kids and for their loved ones? It's a true form of joy. I'm going to talk to you tonight a little bit about joy versus you. Can everybody stand? We're going to take our text from Hebrews 12, 2 through 4. It says, keeping our eyes on Jesus, the source and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that lay before him endured a cross and despised the shame, has sat down at the right hand of God's throne. For consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, so that you won't grow weary and lose heart. And in struggling against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding of your blood. Can we pray? Heavenly Father, Lord, I just ask you to be with me, Lord. I ask you to use this vessel, use my throat, my mouth, Lord, use my heart and my mind, Lord. Help me to get across, God, what you have given me, Lord. Lord, and I ask you to touch each and every heart and mind and ears today to hear what you'd have them hear. Lord, and I just praise you, and I give you all the glory and all the honor. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, there's a struggle in the Christian church today. I'm not saying God's church. I'm talking about Christian church. See, the Declaration of Independence says that we are empowered with inalienable rights. We have the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. But I think that there's a problem there with that happiness, because we've taken away what it truly means, the understanding of what happiness is. See, that should have been set for joy, because we are a country that's founded on the doctrine of God, not the United States. And when the founding fathers said the pursuit of happiness, they were thinking in the process of the Bible. They were thinking the processes of what God had to say. But the problem after a few hundred years of Satan manipulating the church and manipulating our words, that word happiness isn't the same as it was when they wrote, when they penned it in the Declaration of Independence. It's not. See, they've interchanged joy for happiness in the church in the United States. And that happiness isn't the joy that Jesus was talking about in Hebrews. It's not. See, now today, it's easy. See, happiness is this. Here's the Webster Dictionary definition of it. It says the agreeable sensations which spring forth from enjoyment of good. That state of being in which his or her desires are gratified. That's not what joy is. That's a form of happiness that's a lie, that's a trap. It's a ploy of Satan, because you can never truly, and if you get into the bottom of Webster's Dictionary, it says that you can never attain happiness, true happiness. Because happiness is fleeting. Happiness is a sensation. It's whatever exists for that moment. It's only in that moment that happiness is. It's a sensation. Joy is not that way. See, we've forgotten what true joy is. It says, for the joy, Jesus endured the cross. It's for the joy that he endured it because of us. Because he knew that we couldn't be saved unless he went to that cross. He was looking down to eternity at you and I today and realizing that you and I have no way to get back to that covenant relationship with God unless he went on that cross. I guarantee you he wasn't happy about it. I guarantee you he wasn't happy when they tied him to that post. I guarantee you he wasn't happy when they started beating him with rods. I guarantee you he wasn't happy when they started beating him with a cat of nine tails and his flesh was exposed. I can guarantee you that, because he walked here as a man. He came to this world as a man to show us how to walk as a man. See, and we have substituted joy for happiness. That sensation, when that sensation leaves us, guess what? Despair takes its place a lot of times. See, so many times we look at the things around us, and if they don't make us happy, they make us sad. God says, I want you to look at things through my eyes, the way that I see things. I look at things through joy. There's a lot of times I have seen young people totally mistreat their mothers, and yet their mothers love them anyway. That's not happiness. That's a form of joy that God gave them when they looked at them when they were born, because they carried them. There's a special relationship between a child and a mother that a man can never understand. Because if I see kids get up in the face like I've seen other kids get up in face of their mother, I would want to choke them out or take them out of this world. But a mother loves them unconditionally, just like our Father loves us unconditionally. See, and we forget about that sometimes because we've substituted happiness for joy. And we have to realize that only in true joy can we find that relationship with God. See, you can't find joy. Joy's not out there. It can only be accessed through the covenant relationship of Jesus Christ. That's the only place you can find true joy, is in that covenant relationship. Because here's the problem. A lot of people have substituted relationship or uniformity as relationship with God. There's a lot of people that sit on a pew day in and day out, week in, year out, that don't have a relationship with God. They're just simply uniform to the church. And that's all it is. The Song of Solomon says this. It says, young women of Jerusalem, swear to me by the gazelles or by the does in the field that you will not awaken love or arouse love before its proper time. See, there is a chemical that is released in our brain when we fall in love. There is a chemical reaction that happens in our brain when we're addicted, when we take drugs. There's certain drugs that entice that chemical to be made in our brain. And see, the pursuit of happiness is getting younger and younger and younger in young people. They think that everything has to make them happy. Now, if you get into the kids into sports and they're real little, there's no loser. Everybody wins. Everybody has to be maintained a level of happiness in this sport. No one loses. Everyone plays. Everyone gets a trophy. There's no one to lose. There's no one to win. But that's not reality. They grow up in that. And guess what? When you walk out into the real world, bad things happen to good people. Now my happiness no longer exists. And when it changes, when that sensation changes, when the thing that was making me happy changes in my life, I don't know how to deal with the tragedy. I don't know how to accept defeat. I don't know how to accept the things that happen to me that's bad. I talk to many people, and then they think when they come to the Lord that everything's going to be great. Paul, when he came to the Lord, Jesus himself told him, you're going to suffer many things for my name's sake. Many things. Not just a few, but many. But yet, every time I see and I talk to people today, and some adversity comes their way or a problem comes their way, they immediately start doubting God. Start doubting their convictions or start doubting if God's real or why would he allow this to happen. That's exactly how Adam beguiled Eve in the Garden of Eden. All he wanted to do was cause a doubt in her mind about God and who he is. See, I told you the joy starts in that covenant relationship with Jesus Christ. But the way that joy grows is the more that you understand who this God is that we serve. You want your joy to grow? Get in the Word of God and understand who God really is. Understand that he is the author and perfecter of our faith. See, it's easy when we first get saved and we do nothing else with it. We have this little bit of joy. And we hold on to it dearly. But we don't do anything else with it. We don't learn anything else about God. We just look for happiness and we got this little bit of joy and the world comes and chokes it out of us. And we wonder where it went. Why don't I have that joy when I first got saved? Because you don't exercise in that joy. You don't learn about this God that we serve. The God that we serve created everything. Every cell, every molecule that you can look at and the stuff that you cannot see, he created it. It belongs to him. You belong to him. There is nothing that is created or not created that does not belong to the God that we serve. And we forget who he is because that joy, Jesus had joy and he knew what was going to happen to him. There are people, I remember Fanny, that lady was something to me. I only knew her for a very short period of time. But that lady was one of the nicest ladies and she was dying the whole time that I knew her. She said, if God doesn't heal me here, he'll heal me over there. Amen. But she had a smile on her face. She had a glow about her. She was the blackest lady I ever met. The first time I met her, she was a big woman. I was in a steel cage. It was just me and her in this building. They were closing one of the ITP's over in Cincinnati. And you had to come in through a door, and then it was a steel grate to get in, and you had to come through another door, Mike. And that's to keep people, it was a security door. But it was all closed. And let me tell you, this lady was not little. I'm a pretty good sized guy. But she put me in, she walked in the door, and she had the buttons over there to unlock and lock the doors. She let me in, got me there, and I don't know if this was a God thing or it's just her sense of humor. She put me in there, and she goes, "Hey, white boy, I don't know if I'll let you out here. You look kind of cute." I'm like, "Oh, God." I was scared. I'm locked in a steel cage. I can't get out on either side. And let me tell you, this was a steel cage. It wasn't a little door that you could kick open. It was, I mean, it was a security doors on both ends. And it was locked. And we were in a dark building, and there was only a couple things there. And it was just me and her, and she's like, she started laughing. And let me tell you, she was on the other side, and it was dark. I couldn't see much of her. I could just hear her talking. And I was like, "Do I got anything? I usually carry a knife and stuff like this on me." I'm like, I was a little nervous. But I come to find out who this lady was, and she was one of the nicest ladies I had ever met. This world is a lesser place because she left it. But when I first met her, she was a character, you know, but she was dying, and she knew it. But you could never tell it. Never could you tell it in her conversation that you spent any time with. I spent several, probably a few weeks total in the last few years with her, closing out the companies and stuff like this, and you could never tell that she was even sick, except that she had lost probably 250 pounds. And then I went over and talked to one of the ladies there, and they said she had passed on. That's what I'm talking about, joy. You know, Brenda's going through what she's going through, but she has a positive attitude. You know, my wife did a lot of crying in the beginning, and I said, you know what, she got saved. Her heart's right with God. That's the only thing that matters. It's not what we go through. It's not when you step over into the glory world, you're not going to have a scar or a blemish on you. Amen. The only person that's going to have a scar or blemish in glory world is Jesus Christ. He is the only one for eternity. I'm almost going to cry. He's the only one in eternity that's going to have a scar. The only one that's going to have a blemish. He's going to make you perfect. You and I will be perfect in heaven, and he's the only one that's going to walk around blemished. It makes me want to cry. Because nothing, it says in there, nothing. You go back to Hebrews 2 and 4, it says that you and I are not asked to give our blood. Jesus poured out his blood on the cross of Calvary for us. He poured it out so that you and I might have a covenant relationship with God. That he took back what we gave to Satan, our relationship with God. And we take it so lightly, so just nonchalantly. But in Solomon it says, don't arouse this. Don't awaken it. Because this generation is trying to find happiness at such a young age, they are opening up themselves to allowing themselves to put a multitude of things in there. When you allow that lust and those chemicals to go into your mind, and they start this love awakening in your brain, it never goes back. I tell young people, when you start into a relationship with that significant other, it's like going up steps. When you're down there, you're holding hands, everything's cool. But you take the next step, you can't go back. You start sleeping around and everything else, you can't take that back. God can heal you, don't get me wrong, but you can't take that back. That's why God said, don't do that. Because he knew it was going to be a trap laid for young people and old people alike. Why do people continue to do drugs and do all these things? They are looking for a happiness that they cannot find outside of Jesus Christ. They want that happiness. They crave it. They look for it. And Satan knows it, and he uses it as a trap. He uses it as a stumbling block. He uses it for the point of to cause you to have despair. He wants you and I to walk around in a hopeless state. Because if you and I are walking around in a hopeless state, this world has no one to tell them about Jesus Christ. No one. We have an obligation to this world to tell people about Jesus Christ. And we're supposed to be joyful in doing it. Joy is acquired. It's acquired. We have to realize that. Joy is not based upon our circumstances, but in the confidence that comes from that relationship with Jesus Christ. It's in those things. It's in that relationship with Jesus when Jesus gives us everything that we need to have a joyful life. If you're saved, your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. There is nothing on this earth you should fear. Because there's nothing to hold you back. Because if they kill you, Paul said in Philippians, he said, I wish they would kill me. Because that would benefit me more than staying here. Because I get to go and be with Jesus. It's when we doubt Jesus is who he is that fear rises into the relationship. See, it's when that cancer comes or that illness comes or something that comes between you and I and God, it's that fear that Jesus isn't who he says he is. Because if Jesus is who he says he is, and we're absolutely sure that that's the truth, and we're sure in that relationship with him, we should not fear death. We should not fear anything that this world throws at us. Because if it's a monetary thing, if it's an illness, if whatever it is, if we truly believe in Jesus is who he is, Jesus is in control of every situation. But so many times we will look at Jesus can take care of Wayne, but he can't take care of me. My situation is not his. But there was a man in the Bible. There was a father that went to Jesus and said, heal my son. And he says, all you need is faith. And the man fell on the ground and said, I ain't got faith. He said, help my unbelief. And Jesus healed his son. Sometimes we just need to be honest with Jesus and honest with God and say, you know what? This illness has got me down. And I got a little bit of doubt. I'm walking on happiness instead of joy. And there's a little bit of doubt inside of me, God. And I need your help. Is God faithful and just to hear that? Absolutely. Is he faithful and just to fix that? If you allow him. But it's going to take some prayer. It's going to take some fasting. It's going to take some doing on your part. Because if you want more faith in God, let me tell you, it's going to through trials and tribulations and problems that faith grows. You're not going to get the joy of the Lord to the point of to endure a cross and lay down your life or let your blood run out. You're not going to have that kind of joy overnight. It takes time. It takes a covenant relationship with God and growing in the faith in God and understanding who God really is in our lives that we can stand up before Pontius Pilate and say, you know what? You're not in control of this situation. God is. God did it as a man here, as Jesus, to show us the way. It was all those quiet times that Jesus had with God that helped him to get to Pontius Pilate and say, you know what? You're not in control of this situation. My father is. We have to realize that. He gave us that example. He showed us how to do it. Paul in Philippians was in prison waiting to be executed. Waiting. Listen, we look at this happiness And we wonder, if I could just get to this, or I could just have this, or if this would work out for me, then I could be happy and my joy would grow. No. Solomon in Ecclesiastes 1:14 said this: I have seen everything done in this world, and I tell you, it's all useless. It's like chasing the wind. Solomon, I was thinking about this, and there's no way that I could tell this, but you could probably take the top 100 richest men in the world today, and they could not even come close to what Solomon had. Solomon had 700 wives. He had multitudes of everything. And when he come down to towards the end of his life, he said, you know what? I have everything. I'm going to check it out. I'm going to do everything. I am not going to withhold anything from myself. There's a lot of rich people that have blown their brains out when they got to the point that he was at. When they realized that all those things that they thought would make them happy didn't really make them happy. And they were still empty inside because they didn't realize that happiness was not joy. And when they tried it all and they did it all and everything else, and they come down to it, just like here in 1:14, he says, you know what? I did not stop anything from myself. And I realize it's all like chasing the wind. There's nothing here for, this world has nothing for me. Nothing. Nothing. But Solomon was the wisest and the wealthiest. Like I said, and he said it was like chasing the wind. But if you go into the end of the book of Ecclesiastes, after this journey that Solomon was on, after the journey, after he had come to the end of it, and he had tried everything, he didn't withhold anything. And I'm going to tell you, when you're the richest man on the planet, and you have anything that your heart could possibly desire, and they're going to put it in front of you, that life and death hangs in the balance of what you say, let me tell you, when he said that there was nothing, there's probably not a desire that any person on this planet has had that he did not fulfill. And he said it was like chasing the wind. But if you go to the end, in Ecclesiastes 12, 13, and 14, this is what Solomon says. After all this, there is only one thing to say. I have reverence for God and obey his commands, because this is all that we were all created for. God is going to judge everything we do, whether good or bad, even the things done in secret. We know from his writings that he had anything that his heart desired. And he said, the only thing, when it comes down to the end of my life, the only thing that's important that I have found in this journey that I went on, that I was told myself that I would not exclude anything, is God. Philippians 1:27 says this. It says, now, the important thing is that your way of life should be as the gospel of Christ requires. So that whether or not I am able to come and see you, I will hear that you are standing firm in one common purpose, and that with only one desire you are fighting together for the faith of the gospel. Don't be afraid of your enemies. Always be courageous. This will prove to them that they will lose. It's when you and I go through the things of this world and we stand up and we say, I am still a child of God. God's still in control of this. Every time we say that, the enemy says, you know what? I lose. I lose. Because it's in those things that people that are contrary to the word of God lose their ability to argue. Well, God, you know, he's not really this. He's not yet. Yeah, I realize that. But do you realize that I've got cancer and God's taking care of me every step of the way? What's the enemy going to say to that? He has nothing to say. He has to shut his mouth and realize that he's lost. And he moves on to another person. He moves on to another situation that he can try to put his hand in to try to destroy. Don't be afraid. For you have been given the privilege of serving Christ, not only by believing in him, but also by suffering for him. It's in our suffering that we allow God's Spirit to get inside of us and we still have that joy. That's where it makes the difference. It's easy on the mountaintop to praise God and to go to work and tell people how great God is. It's easy to do that. This world has enough easy in it. This world's looking for all the easy ways out. They talk about it. This is a microwave society. But we have a crockpot God. This world is looking for the easiest way out of everything. Even the video games that they make that they say, oh, this is great. First thing they do is create a cheat sheet for it. This game costs $39.95, but if you spend $12, you can get the cheat sheet and it shows you all the shortcuts. What's the point in playing the game? You know what I mean? I don't know the Wii bowling. There's a way that you can throw a 300, but the ball never even hits the alley. I don't know how to do it, but they told me. What's the point in playing the game? There's no point in it. None. None at all. Now listen to Paul. This is one of them. I got cold chills. He says, after you have the privilege of serving Christ, not only by believing in him, but also by suffering for him. We all know Paul. We know who he was. He's standing in prison waiting to be judged. Probably going to be killed, whatever the reason. In Philippians 1:30, I found this translation, and I like it. After all you read in Philippians, and it tells about all the stuff that's going on, and if you read, it tells you the things that happened to him and everything else. But in Philippians 1:30, it says this. It says, now. Everybody say, now. Now you can take part with me in the battle. Let me tell you, I was thinking about this when I read that. I read this translation and I was like, how many people want to go into a battle with somebody who's never been in a battle? How many people want to go to war with somebody that's never been in a war? When they take those first few troops and they send them in, they're not battle hardened. We're taught, don't get me wrong. We're taught all the things to do, but until those bullets start whizzing by your head, it ain't real. You know what I'm saying? All the training in the world, and putting on gas masks and all the bullets and all the accuracy, that's all cool and fine and dandy. But until someone's shooting back at you, that target don't shoot back at you. Amen? But that's why they always take seasoned veterans and put them with fresh troops. Because it gives the fresh troops a fighting chance to last a few days, Mike, to actually become veterans. See, when I was overseas, I worked on a nuclear missile base. If war broke out, my life expectancy was 17 minutes. There was 300 men on top of this mountain in a farmer's field who worked on a nuclear missile base. They already had us targeted. They already knew exactly where we were, but we were one of the first strike people. 17 minutes was our life expectancy. In that 17 minutes, we was going to hit us first. What they would do is we had a direct line to the White House, to our admin area. We had to live long enough to get off a couple missiles and to call the president and say we're at war. That was our job. First thing that the guy told me when I walked in, the colonel told me, he said, you signed up for this, but you're only going to live 17 minutes if the war breaks out. That's just the truth of it. But what I'm saying is, Paul says, Now that you've suffered, how many of you in here have suffered for Christ? Three or four of us? You've never suffered an affliction for Christ? You never did any suffering at all? It says, now that you've suffered a little bit and you believe in him, now you're ready for battle. Now that joy is made complete. Now that you got a little joy and you understand you got a little suffering underneath your belt, let's go to war. See, this world doesn't understand that. The churches, there's churches closing their doors. Why? Because when suffering comes, instead of standing up and facing it and realizing that it's coming from God to help us with our joy, they fold because it's not happy. We ain't got happy time. We need family time because family time makes me happy. It's not in my happiness that my joy is made complete. It's in suffering that joy is made complete. And when we suffer for a little while, Paul says, now come on with me. Let's go really do some battle. Because guess what? I'm going to have to stand in front of this Roman person and I'm going to have to give an account. I got to stand up for Christ. Why? Because he poured out his life's blood on the cross for me. What I endure here is for a little while. But Paul says, you know what? It's worth it. It's worth it. See, we have to tell people, hey, it's time for battle. Have you suffered a little while? Because if you're not suffering, guess what you're not doing? You're not standing up for Christ. Because when you stand up for Christ, you get a big bullseye on your chest. You get this person called Satan. He don't like you. He wants to kill and destroy you. And how does he do that? By suffering. He wants to make you suffer. What is it, John 10:10? Satan says, I've come to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus said, I come to give you what? And give you more. But yet he says, I'm going to give you more abundant life, but there's going to be suffering along with it. But when we stand up and we get angry with God and we walk around with a sad face, mad at God or whatever the reason, what are we doing? We're telling God, I don't want you to make me suffer. I want to be happy. I want to go through this life with my head held high, with a smile on my face. Jesus said, I wanted that too, but it wouldn't have got you to heaven. It wouldn't have helped you get there. Listen, the church today wants enough of Christ to feel good. But they don't want to give up enough of this world to be changed. The only way that you can be full of joy is to be changed by Christ. It's in that transformation, that transforming of your mind, that your joy is made complete. Webster's Dictionary says that there is no way that happiness can be contained or created on this planet. Can I submit to you tonight that if you have the joy of the Lord and you truly know who Jesus Christ is as your personal Savior and that he is the Son of the living God, then I can say that your joy is complete. But with that completeness comes a little suffering, a little hard times, a little trouble, a little trials. It might even take your life. Paul goes on to tell the Philippians, he said, you know what, there's hard times coming your way. One of the commentaries I read said in just a few short years, they killed 11,000 Christians. Persecution is coming, church. Whether you're, just because you're sitting on a pew, it's going to be coming your way. And it's going to do one of two things. It's going to create in you desire to have joy and have a covenant relationship with Jesus Christ, or it will drive you out of this church. Persecution on your job, from the government, whoever it is, but it's coming in these last days. Because it says in the Bible that it's going to come to the point where sisters and mothers and daughters are going to go against each other and fathers and sons are going to go against each other for this gospel. This world is getting so bad that it's going to come to the point that when you say that you're a Christian, they're going to persecute you so bad for it, you're either going to be real or get out. Jesus said, "Verily, verily, I don't know who you are. But we did all this stuff for you." And he goes, "I don't know who you are." That's not by accident that that's in there. It's a shame. It breaks my heart that it's in there. There's people sitting on a pew every day that don't know who Jesus Christ is. They have a uniform look of Christian, but they have no form of Christianity or power. None. They have no relationship with Jesus Christ at all. They only go to church because it's what they've been doing since they were kids. They have no desire to get closer to God. They have no desire to know about this joy that I'm talking about. They have no desire at all. They just want to come and feel better about themselves, make themselves feel better for a little bit, be happy, and go out and live their life and do what they want to do and have that form of happiness. And that form of happiness, when you die and you leave this world, will split hell wide open. And you're like, "Oh, I went to church and I did this." I'm not telling you that church is not great, because it is. This church is one of the best. But there's people in this church, and I'm not fooling myself, there's people in this church right now that do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ. But they say that they're a Christian. But only you and God know that your heart is right or wrong with God. You and you alone, and God knows that if you were to leave this world today, you would split hell wide open. And I don't care what you're wearing on that day. I don't care what your garb is. I don't care what your robe is. It makes no difference, because the circumcision is in the heart. If you don't have the heart for God, if you don't have the desire, that joy, let me tell you, it doesn't matter how many people or what your tithes you paid or whatever you've done for God. It makes no difference without that relationship. And you will leave this place and you'll walk out of here and you have doubt, because Satan is telling you it's okay because you're going to be happy. Happiness does not equate to salvation, because happiness is fleeting. It's like a train headed to a place that we have no clue of. It's headed to hell. And the joy train is a problem train, because it's going to cause you problems. It's going to give you heart attacks. It's going to give you whatever this world has to throw at you, but you can stand up and say, "I'm still a child of God." Job. We look at all the bad things that happened to us. Look at Job. Why is that in there? To show us the things that Satan can put on a man, and a man still not lose his integrity with God. Jesus, he was God's son. Don't get me wrong. He walked as a man, but here was a man that, a real man. He was born of a woman. But you and I have to decide if we want to walk in happiness or walk in joy. Happiness is fleeting. Happiness is only for a moment. It's only as long as my circumstances are conducive for that atmosphere. That's all it is. And when that changes, my attitude changes. Joy, your attitude is always the same. It's for me and my house. We'll serve the Lord. You and I have to choose that. You have to make up your mind that I'm going to follow and seek after joy, not happiness. I see so many people, they talk about it all the time. If I could only do this, or if I could only have that. That's not joy. The things that we take into our body. This world, we live in a society now where unless Mama Rosie's cooking it, it's not probably, most of the time, it's just fast food. You know what I'm saying? It's killing us. The United States is so obese, it's ridiculous. You got to have protein to live. God's protein. Happiness, the joy is the things that sustain us. Happiness is just chocolate. It's just ice cream. It gives you a headache if you eat it too fast. It makes your teeth fall out. It makes you fat. But yet, We shove it in by the buckets full. I remember the TV commercial. The guy goes over and gets a little 12-ounce Coke, and the other guy comes over and he's got a, this here, the guy's like, just give me a bucket. The other guy comes wheeling in with a 55-gallon drum. Give me a 55-gallon drum of Coke. You know? How much stuff can you stuff down your throat and think it makes you happy? It doesn't. We need the sustaining power of joy in our lives. Joy stands for this: Jesus, others, yourself. Jesus modeled that. Jesus said, I came to be a what? Servant. To serve others. He served us to the cross. When you talk about you, talk about yourself, others, and uniformity. There's no Jesus. There's no Jesus in that. There's enough churches full of yous. We need joy. We need Jesus as the first part in everything that we do. So many times we think of ourselves first. What helps me be the person? What can I do to make myself better? Your life in Christ makes you strong, and His love comforts you. You have fellowship with the Spirit, and you have kindness and compassion for one another. I urge you then to make me completely happy by having the same thoughts, sharing the same love, being in one soul and one mind. Don't do anything from yourself, selfish ambitions, or from cheap desire to boast, but be humble toward one another, always considering others better than yourself. Look out for one another's interests, not just your own. The attitude you should have is the one that Christ had. He always had the nature of God, but he did not think that by force he should be tried to remain equal with God. But instead of this, of his own free will, he gave up all he had and took on the nature of a servant. He became like a human being and appeared in human likeness. He was humble and walked the path of obedience all the way to death, his death on the cross. For this reason, God raised him to the highest place above and gave him the name that is greater than any other name. And so in honor of that name, Jesus, all being in heaven and earth and in the world below will fall to their knees. And all will openly proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of the Father. So then, dear friend, as you always obeyed me when I was with you, it is even more important that you obey me now while I am away from you. Keep on working with fear and trembling to complete your salvation. Because God is always at work in you to make you willing and able to obey his purpose. Do everything without complaining and arguing, so that you may be innocent and pure as God's perfect children who live in a world of corrupt and sinful people. You must shine among them like the stars lighting up the sky. You and I, when we allow God, or we allow the things of this world to affect us, we are taking that light that God gave us and we're casting it to the side. No matter what comes our way, the Bible says that God said he will never put on you more than you're able to bear. Some people are able to bear more weight than others. God knows that. He knows exactly who you are. He knows exactly what he wants you to go through, because he knows the people that are around you that are in utter darkness, and they need that light to shine. And as long as everything's going right with us, that light shines, but it doesn't have any effect. All of us in here, if we have the light of God inside of us, it's real bright in here. But guess what? There's nothing out there illuminating the outside. There's nothing out there illuminating. It's when we go out into the darkness and we go out amongst the people that are in this world of darkness, that's where that illumination means the most. We come in here to draw strength from one another, to care about one another, and then go out and do ministry. That's what we're here for, to lift each other up. I like this. It says, pure as God's perfect children who live in a world of corrupt and sinful people, you must shine among them like stars lighting up the sky. As you offer them the message of life, if you do so, I shall have reason to be proud of you on the day of Christ, because it will show that all my effort and work have not been wasted. Paul said, when Jesus met him on that road, and Jesus told him, said, you know what, Paul, you're going to suffer. Man, you're going to suffer. You're going to suffer for my name's sake. There are some people here suffering a lot worse than me. And there's probably going to be people after that's going to suffer a lot worse. But no one suffered like Christ did, because he bore the sins of every one of us. We forget that. We forget the Savior that saved us and how he saved us and what he had to go through to save us. I thought about getting a painting done of Christ on the cross, because I never want it to be far from my thoughts, because I never want to forget what he did for me. It's easy in this world to get blindsided by your own things that happens to you and I. It's easy to happen. Satan's really good at manipulating that, putting a veil up, a cloud up. It's easy. But I never want it to be forgotten what he did for me. Never. We have just enough of Christ to be informed. Because everybody in here, on the side of my voice, was informed about Christ tonight. But if you got enough guts to come up and talk to the living God and lay down enough of this world to be transformed by God? That's my question. It's easy to come to church and be informed about God. You don't have to do anything. You don't have to change anything. You just got to take the cell phone out of your ear, the iPod out of your ear, be a little bit attentive, and you can be informed about Christ. But unless you make a concerted effort, unless you just make a desire to have a covenant relationship with Christ, you will never be transformed by God. You'll never be transformed by Christ unless you choose to be transformed. We hold on to enough of this world to never be transformed. We hold on because there's a little bit of doubt in our mind that says, well, what if that Muslim's right? What if that person that told me that there's another way, what if he's right? You know what? I have tried the world's way. I've drank rivers of alcohol. I've did drugs. I've done multitudes of things. But one day, I made a decision to lay it all down. I said, Lord, it's on the left-hand side of Cold Springs. I said, Lord, I have tried it my way for 38 years. I have tried it my way for years and years and years. I don't know if you're real. I don't know if this is true. But I'll give you 100%. And if you'll take the 100%, I'll follow you wherever you go. I'll tell people whatever you tell me to tell them. And I'll say whatever you tell me to say. And I'll do whatever you tell me to do. And when I did that, I have no more doubt. I don't have fear. I had a demon tell me he was going to kill me. If he kills me, I go to heaven. Big whoop. I don't have fear. May everyone stand. Being informed about Christ brings happiness. Because honestly, this church does a lot of stuff. We got some great people in here. These people don't like to leave. They like being here. They like being amongst each other. That in amongst us, if nothing else, brings happiness. Because this world is looking for people that they can have fellowship with. Being informed about Christ does bring happiness, but it does not bring a transformed life. You have to make a conscious effort to choose to have joy, to allow the God of this earth, this world, this creator, to come into your life and fill your heart with his joy. Let me everyone bow your heads. Heavenly Father, Lord, I truly believe that I have said what you asked me to say. Lord, I truly believe that I've been obedient to you. Lord, and I'm asking you, the great and living God, Lord, if there's anyone here tonight, God, that has been informed but not transformed, Lord, I'm asking you to speak to their heart and to their mind today. Lord, it's going to take a transformed life to make it through this world. We can't walk around just informed about you anymore. Lord, the persecution is going to come. The people in this world are going to cause us to divide. Lord, we have to have a transforming life with you. Lord, I'm asking you to talk to each and every individual here tonight. If you're not saved, if you've just lived an informed life and not a transformed life, I'm going to ask you to come up and talk to the creator of heaven and earth, because he's the only one that can transform your life. And this purpose that Amanda talked about, he has a purpose and a plan for you and I. But it takes a transformed life to fulfill that purpose. This world doesn't need people that's just informed. They need people that's being transformed. If you have doubt, these altars are open. If you have fear, these altars are open. That's between you and God and you and God. I truly believe that God wanted you to hear that. If there's something between you and God that's causing you to doubt, put it on the altar. It's there at the altar that God will meet you, and wherever you're at, that God can take away that doubt. And you can walk out of here with no fear of tomorrow. None. Is there anybody like that tonight? If you have fear to get out of your seat, take somebody by the hand. Take them by the hand. And tell them, I'll come pray with you. Heavenly Father, Lord, I ask you to touch. Holy Spirit, Lord, I'm asking you to speak to hearts tonight. Lord, you know each and every heart that's in this place tonight. You know who they are. You know where they are with you. If they're far from you, if they're hot, they're cold, lukewarm, you know. You're the only person that does know, you and them. Lord, speak to hearts tonight. Church, just find you a place to pray and talk to the creator of heaven and earth. Because if you're not in a problem now, you're probably going to be coming into a problem. And you're not going to need strength to get through that problem. Lord, I just ask you to touch, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Father, touch. Thank you.
without you. Without
Did you enjoy that message? Amen. Give God a hand clap. It was really good. I've been telling those that get up and preach lately, I said, your pastor needs to be preached to, so make sure you preach good. And I mean that sometimes, because sometimes I need to be preached to, and I need to hear from God. Amen. Because you know how it is. Sometimes we tell ourselves about God, but we don't listen very much. Amen. So when you hear it, you hear it. And I'm very appreciative of the message tonight and even what Amanda brought out the other night. Very, very good messages. Proud of our ministers. Amen. Give God a hand clap. It's good. We had Crystal's mom with us this morning, and something Norman preached kind of reminded me of it. Don't know that she's ever been here before, but Crystal was telling me that her mom was telling her on the way home, she said, those people seem to be happy. Those people seem to want to be there. And I said, praise the Lord, man. Because, you know, we want, you know, people that are in here for the first time, we really want them to know and believe that the people here love each other, enjoy each other. They want to be here, amen. And Norman's right. You know, there are many times we have to push people out the door by flipping the lights off on them, amen, because nobody wants to leave. And, you know, I remember as a child, that's the way it was for me going to church sometimes. You know, when it's good, you don't want to leave. You know, when that freedom that Lori's been singing about lately is in the place, you don't want to leave it. You enjoy it, amen. But the thing is, and we have to remember this, we can take this home with us. We really can. We can take this to our jobs with us. We can do that. And if you're ever feeling down, you know, put on a pot of beans and some cornbread and invite some people to your house for church. Amen. You think I'm joking? I'm not joking. Do it. A couple 2 liters of pop. Buddy, we'll be there. We'll have church in your house or in your backyard. Hamburgers and hot dogs. That's all you got to do. We'll be there. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Amen. We'll be there. We love to eat. Yes. Amen. Praise the Lord. I was thinking, too, there was a song that we used to sing when I was a kid. It was "The Joy of the Lord is My Strength." Does anybody remember that? We always call it the ha-ha song. And the reason being, because there is one part, second verse, I don't know, you just go, ha, 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 ha. Anybody remember that? Well, as I was listening to Norman preaching, I thought, well, that's what we need to be saying to the devil, because the joy of the Lord is our strength. And if we have the joy of the Lord, we can look at the devil and go, ha, 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 ha. Do you guys remember it? No. You want to sing it?
Yeah, sure.
Who wants to sing it? Steve, come help me, man. Oh, wait a minute. Paul's got it. Paul, go ahead. Let's go.
The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength.
Come on, Joy.
The joy of the Lord is my strength. Oh, the joy of the Lord is my strength.
Here you go.
Ha, 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 ha,
the first time. Me too.
You know, them Germans got the chicken dance. We got the ha-ha song. Amen. Because that's what it sounded like to me.
Poor deprived people.
Not the last.
Okay,
I was looking at Julie. Julie seemed to be a little embarrassed to sing it. Let's have some fun with it. Amen.
This is the first time
I am supposed to announce the ladies' meeting at Mama's house tomorrow. They will be meeting here to take the church van over. Parking is limited. As you know, our church started there. So if you want to find a parking space, jump in the van. 6:45, right. How many of y'all enjoyed Art singing this morning?
Yeah, yeah.
Amen.
Awesome.
He did really good. That's right. Hey, man. I did not make mention of this, but Art just finished teaching our Financial Peace University course here. And how much debt did we pay off?
I think it was close to $30,000 in 9 weeks. And then, in addition to that, we saved up like $8,000 or $9,000. So paid off almost $30,000 worth of debt, saved up $8,000 or $9,000.
In 9 weeks.
9 weeks.
Give God a hand clap, amen. You see, people think that, you know, there's certain things that you just can't overcome. That's a lie. Norman talked about cheat codes to video games. Believe it or not, you and I have the cheat codes right in front of us in a Bible. Amen. You want to know how to get out of debt? The answer's in there. You want to fix your marriage? The answer's in there. You want true joy? The answer's in there. Amen. Have you had a good time today? I have. God is so good. Make sure you keep telling people about the church. Keep inviting people to the church. Amen. Let's all stand, please. I'm going to pick on somebody right now and have them say our dismissal prayer because her husband sang so nicely this morning. She had to know it was coming. Amen. Brenda, lead us out in prayer, please. Amen. Shake hands and be friendly, please.